make a person make a good life. You gotta make a person make a good life. You gotta make a person make a good life. You gotta make a person make a good life. You gotta make a person make a good life. You gotta make a vote.
Over 1,000 years ago, Africans migrated south. The Xhosa nation settled with their cattle in the eastern part of what is now called South Africa. European settlers arrived in the middle of the 17th century. They fought the Africans and drove them off their land, sowing the seeds of hatred that lasted for centuries. It was here in the Eastern Cape that Nelson Mandela was born in 1918. He was of royal blood, a descendant of Tembu chiefs, part of the Xhosa nation. He was called Rholihlahla Madiba Dalibunga Mandela.
When I went to school, the lady teacher, Miss Mdingane, asked, "What is your name?" I told her my African name, Rholihlahla. She says, "No, I don't want that one. You must have a Christian name." So I say, "No, I don't have one." She says, "You are, from today, you are going to be Nelson." That's how I earned the name Nelson, not given by my parents. In fact, my mother, who has never gone to school, took me one day to a doctor. And the doctor asked, "Now, what is his name?" She said, "Nelisile." His name is Nelisile. Because it was a white name, you see, and they couldn't pronounce it properly.
These graves mean a great deal to me because my beloved parents lie here. And it arouses a great deal of emotion for me to be here, because it would be fair to say part of myself lies buried here.
Besimbona kuba besimoyika ebethu bufikile ubhuti engenandaba zakugeza anozithetha nani ubhuti ningena ugeze khona besimoyika le ndawo yakhe yobunkokheli Saibona, yayibona kahla esemncinci sasimoyika esoyikwa.
Besihlala equ. Izindlu ebesinazo. Phaya equ. Ibizizindlu zesixhosa ezenziwe ngenca. Dluka mama ibidibene nekatata. Sinendlu yethu singabantwana yokubasela. Ikhona indlu yabafana basekhaya yamakhwenkwe.
Sakhula sizingela, sidlala izinduku, silusa izinkomo, sidlela ndawonye.
My father was a polygamist with 4 wives, 9 children. I grew up in that atmosphere where we played together, fought against one another, but ate from one dish. We grew up in the felt, looking after stock, sheep, goats, horses, and cattle. Also, during the day, we do all sorts of things. You hunt rabbits, birds. One of our favorite pastimes was stick fighting. You have one stick on the left hand to parry the blows from the other boys, and then on the right hand, a stick to hit with. By the way, one of the marks of the sticks I still have. Yeah, there it is. I was hit here by another boy. My mother, she was my first friend in the proper sense of the word. She was not an emotional person. She was completely controlled, calm, at peace with herself and with the world. And I had a great deal of respect for her. A lady who never went to school, who could not read and write, but who was able to listen to the enlightened Christian in the village and became a Christian, in spite of the fact that my father wouldn't come near Christianity. She was approached by those neighbors who were, according to the standard of the day, a bit educated, and asked that I should be sent to school. When I went to school, my father then gave me his riding breeches, and he cut it. And then they had a twine, which I used as a belt. And also he gave me his shirt. That is how I went to the school for the first time. Then one evening, I saw my father lying on his back and the two ladies attending to him. And I subsequently learned that he was ill.
Utata utasawugula, wabiza inkosi kwakusithiwa ngujongindaba. Wathi utata kujongindaba, mhlakazi, nasi isicaka sakho. Ndisinikezela kuwe ukuze umfundise lo mntana. Ngoba lo mntana ndiyambona uba inkqubela yakhe ibheka phambili. Uzumfundise siya kukunyamezela isicaka sakho. Ndikhona ke ngokwatsho utata.
Then one evening, he suddenly called to the young wife and asked her to bring her his pipe and tobacco. But because he was coughing, my parents, you know, my mother's consulted and decided not to give him the pipe. But he insisted. And now that I remember very clearly, calling upon the youngest wife, no diamond, give me my tobacco, give me my pipe. Eventually they couldn't resist the pressure and gave him the pipe and lighted it, and he started smoking. Then he became quiet. For some time he started smoking, and I just saw the pipe dropped. That's how he passed away. I went to Mkhwebezweni when I was 9. The regent, David Dalenjewo, brought me to his place so that he could bring me up. He had 2 children, Justice, who was going to be the heir to the chieftaincy, and a daughter called Nomafu. He brought me up as his own child. He wanted me to be the chief counselor to the king. That was what I was groomed for. I grew up. That is the one. And we'll just go inside. I slept here with the future chief of this area, Justice Mtikhaga, the father of the present chief. So he was a sportsman. He played rugby, he played soccer, he played cricket. He was 4 years older than myself. He is a person who loved me very much. I grew up in Aninkuni. This was the royal court, the king's court. So you were dealing with elders of the tribe who were experts in tribal custom and law. As a boy, I would bring food to them. I would bring a beer to them. And I would perform errands for them. It was from them that I heard about the battles of olden times. The battles that were fought from the Fish River by the Xhosas. The series of wars over 100 years. Our people fighting with spears against gunpowder. They told these stories and the bravery of the traditional leaders who led those battles.
To become an advisor to the king, Nelson needed higher education. And with the support of the chief, he went to the best schools available to blacks.
The first college I went to, I concentrated on my studies. That is where I did my standard 6, form 1, form 2, form 3, in Clarkbury, the one we visited. I have got a special interest in all students, all teachers in this country. It is absolutely important that you have the knowledge to serve your country and your people. Out of you, we are going to have members of parliament, ambassadors, prime ministers. You are going to command our armies. Every one of you are potential leaders who, if they take the challenge, will change the face of South African history. And that is my dream. Diabola. Then I went to Hilltown in the Ciskei for my trick. Now the principal, Dr. Wellington, used to address us and say, I am a descendant of the famous Duke of Wellington who crushed Napoleon and saved civilization for Europe and for you, the natives. And those days would clap, you see. It was when I was in Hilltown that the poet Mkai visited the institution. And in the course of reciting, he called all the nations of the world to come before him because he was going to divide the stars. And he says, you Europeans, the English, the Germans, the French, I give you the constellation because it is the largest group of stars in creation. I am giving you this group of stars because you are greedy nations. You quarrel over plenty. You have started wars which have caused, brought suffering and grief to millions of people throughout the world. Then he called the nations of Asia and Africa. And at the end of it, he says, now you come, House of Xhosa. Inkwenkwezi ebaluleke ngaphezu kwezinye inkwenkwezi. Inkwenkwezi yokubala iminyaka. Iminyaka yobudoda. It is the custom amongst the classes that when a boy reaches a certain age, he should undergo circumcision. It is so deeply entrenched that even in prison, prisoners circumcised one another. I was 16 years of age when we were taken to the circumcision school. We discarded our clothing and we were instructed to sit on new blankets with our legs open. And I heard the first boy saying, Ndindoda, I am a man. Which is what you're supposed to say the moment the expert has cut your foreskin. It is an assegai, a spear, not sterilized, no anesthetic. It just catches your foreskin and in a quick movement, like this. And before I was aware of it, the operation was over. But the pain had gone right into my bones, into my marrow. And as this operation is being conducted, the men are looking very carefully in your face to see what your reaction is going to be. Because when you say, I am a man, they wanted to see it themselves. The body language must also say so. And I must confess that the pain paralyzed me momentarily. And I was not as forthright and strong as the other boys that preceded me. Hearts that they destroy by fire. You have buried your childhood. You have entered now the phase of a man. A very outstanding speech was made by the brother of the king, Chief Meliqili. He addressed us and said, what a pleasure to see such young men who are now going to handle the affairs of the tribe. There are those who are going to go back to school, but they will never be anybody in this country because of the policy of the white man. They will be soldiers. Will never be able to fight for the freedom of your people because they will have no guns. Nevertheless, we expect that now that you are men, you will fight for the liberation of your people from the bondage which has been cast upon us by the white men. I came to Johannesburg in April 1941, running away from a forced marriage. The girl to whom I was going to get married was in love with justice. So this was a problem for us. We decided to run to Johannesburg.
In the 1940s, Johannesburg was a boom town. Mandela and his cousin Justice joined thousands of Africans pouring into the city in search of work.
We went to Crown Mines, where the king had arranged for Justice to get a job there. The Induna said, but the king did mention this to me, but he didn't actually say you were coming. So Justice was very clever. He says, no, he said, because he had spoken to you, there was no need for an introduction. and that I could bring my brother here to get a job. And the donor said, oh, yes. No, that's true. He had mentioned about you, and we'll fix up your brother. Gave him a job as a watchman for a week or two, also at preparing a space for him. But you, you'll get a job as a clerk. One afternoon, the Induna came to our office. Justice, where's the letter from the king? And Justice said, but we had discussed the matter with you when we arrived. No, 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 no. The king could never allow you to come here without a written letter authorizing you to come here. And that I should give you a job. Where's the letter from the king? No, but we had explained this. And he took out a telegram. Here is a telegram from the king. Send boys home at once. Send boys home at once. You must go home.
Mandela defied the chief's order to go home, and at 23, with no job and no money, he ended up in Alexandra, a black ghetto outside Johannesburg.
Hired a room with a family, the Thomas. This was a very kind family because on Sundays they would give me a dish at lunch, food at lunch, meat, rice, vegetables. And it would be brought to me by one of their ladies. A very attractive girl. Now, I wanted to take her out, but I was conscious that she's in a class far above me. My boyfriend was a chap with a beautiful modern suit, a hat, you know, and a suit with a waistcoat. And he would stand outside the yard, you know, waiting for her with hands, you know, in his waistcoat. And I could look at this chap and I feel.
was in my agency, here was a budding young man who could take a leading position. And once he is a lawyer, he could be the great asset in the community.
In 1942, Mandela moved into the Sisulu's tiny house in Soweto. He studied law at night, and each day took the train to Johannesburg, where he worked as a clerk in the law office, a job that Sisulu had got for him. Through Sisulu, his interest in politics grew, and politics for Sisulu meant the African National Congress. The ANC, founded in 1912, was the oldest and largest black political party opposing white minority rule.
It was when I came into the African National Congress that I realized that Xhosas are only a part of the African people. That the task of the ANC was to unite the African people and out of them build a nation.
Another major influence in Mandela's life was Oliver Tambo, a brilliant student and debater. He had also set his sights on becoming a lawyer.
Mandela was less of intellectually confident. And Tambo was always the thinker, the reflector, who Mandela enormously looked up to. That partnership between the two, I think, was always crucial, much more than people realize. The combination of this rather monkish intellectual, very Christian figure of Tambo, and the more military, the more, as it were, physically confident and commanding presence of Mandela, with strong pressure from Tambo Sisulu Mandela, the African National Congress was in fact becoming much more a liberation movement.
Nelson always stuck out. No matter how hard he tried, I mean, he joined the boxing club and he went off with the chaps jogging, and he believed, I think, that he was just one of the crowd. He was just like everybody else, but he could never pull it off.
Mr. Mandela tended to be kingly. You were careful what you said to him even then. I mean, he was young, athletic, loved boxing. But when you spoke to Mr. Mandela, you chose your words carefully.
I joined the African National Congress by becoming a member of the Youth League in 1944. And that is the year in which I got married.
You got married in October. And then we stayed together. And we had no house as well, because the house was very scarce that time. We were staying with my sister at City Deep Mines. Nelson was studying. So I got some post at the mines, and I worked there for about a year. And the salary was very low. £7 10 that time. It was terrible.
News from Government House Pretoria, where South Africa's newly elected Prime Minister, Dr. Malan, was sworn in by the Governor General of the Union, Mr. Van Zyl, at the beginning of a new chapter in South Africa's history.
Comrade Oliver said, "Well, I like this, because we now know we have an enemy in power. And I think that we're going to have a better opportunity of mobilizing our people."
They came in the heat of rum to freeze at the beat of my drum. Oh, people, take note. I wasn't allowed to vote. They sang a song, sharp as the devil's prong. They spoke in the gun and rifle tone, and I answered in the language of stone.
Our policy is one which is called by an Afrikaans word, apartheid. And I'm afraid that has been misunderstood so often. It could just as easily and perhaps much better be described as a policy of good neighborliness. Accepting that there are differences between people, but while these differences exist, and you have to acknowledge them, at the same time, you can live together, aid one another, but that it can best be done when you act as good neighbors always do.
The reality of apartheid was that whites ruled, blacks served. The everyday symbol of apartheid was the pass, the identity document that was a black person's proof of existence. Without it, you were illegal. A policeman could demand to see your pass anytime, anywhere, and if you didn't have it, you were thrown into jail. All black ghettos were destroyed or removed simply because they were too close to white homes.
In 1952, we launched the Defiance Campaign, where we selected 6 unjust laws and defied them so that we can go to jail and be able to focus attention on these unjust laws. We had to train the volunteers to show them how they should resist provocation by the regime. All our people had accepted that those who participate in this struggle had to be absolutely disciplined and non-violent.
In any difficult situation, the first one to volunteer would be Nelson. Who led the June 26 strike in 1950? Nelson Mandela. Who presented a plan for civil disobedience? Nelson Mandela. Who is the first volunteer? Nelson Mandela. He avoided all the clashes for position in the organization. He never got involved. I mean, we elected him to the position of president of the ANC Youth League. In his absence, he wasn't even there.
In 1953, Mandela and Tambo became partners in the first African law firm in the country.
Their office was more like a crowded doctor's waiting room than a legal office where people come by appointment. Oliver was the better theoretical lawyer than Nelson, but nobody could really touch Nelson as a trial lawyer whose presence was really felt.
When he walked into court, everybody took note of him. The prosecutor, the magistrate, the interpreter, the police constables, to say nothing of the public gallery. All he needed to do was to turn around and look, and there's almost a flare-up of enthusiasm around him.
He upset prosecutors, policemen, and magistrates for not being subservient, particularly when he cross-examined whites. Women would be absolutely shocked that an African could stand up and ask them questions.
I once heard a case of rape where a black man had raped a white woman. One of the essential points of the charge in rape is that there should have been penetration. So when I cross-examined her on this, for her in a court of law, in the presence of black clients, to admit that there was penetration was something too serious, too humiliating. And she said, no. I said, but Are you saying that your statement that you gave to the police was wrong? Are you saying that there was no penetration? He says there was no penetration. And of course, that was the essence of the case.
In 1955, the ANC put out a call to opposition groups of all races from all over the country. They came together to approve the Freedom Charter. The charter spelled out the demands for the creation of a free, democratic, and multiracial South Africa. Mandela, one of the key organizers of the event, had been prohibited by the police from attending any public gatherings. He watched secretly from the sidelines.
He could do anything for the politics. The family comes second, but the politics comes first.
He was hardly ever around. He was organizing. In those days, you didn't travel by planes, when you were organizing the ANC, you travel by whatever lift you could get, or you travel by bus, or you travel by train. So you were away from home all that much longer.
Sometimes you would go home and come back in the early hours of the morning. And when I asked him, where have you been? No, I have no policeman in the house to ask where I've been. Can't ask me that. So, all right, I kept quiet.
Evelyn herself didn't think that the marriage was ending, although they had separated and she was living in one part of Orlando and he was living in another part of Orlando. She was still hopeful that they would get together.
You must part. See, Evelyn, I feel that I have no love for you anymore. I'll give your children and the house. And I said, no, I'm not to agree to that. So I want to punish that. I don't want the divorce.
In 1957, Mandela divorced Evelyn, leaving their three children in her custody.
I remember the first time my mother came to Johannesburg. Two white policemen went home whilst I was at work, and they could speak Xhosa very well. And they said to her, look, Mom, we have come to warn you. Ask your son to go back home to the Transkei. He is getting into trouble. He has already been in jail. And he will die in jail. He at least has got a profession. I just turned qualified as a lawyer. Has got a profession. He is mixing up with people who have no professions, mischief makers, agitators. We have nothing to lose. Tell your son to go back home and assume his position. By the time I returned in the afternoon, my mother was waiting for me at the gate. And she says, you must go home. You can't be getting in and out of prison. That's a disgrace. There were two whites here and who spoke very well like parents. And they say, I must send you home. So I realized that I must start at home by preaching politics.
Well, he was strikingly handsome. And in those days, he didn't have this lean figure. He was a big man. And the first thing that attracted you to him was his physical presence, which was so very attractive. Then, of course, they had a sense of humor, and he pulled your legs, you know. I mean, he cracked jokes, and he teased, you see. So there was that part. So you fell into a very easy relationship with him.
I can remember, as if it was yesterday, this tall, elegant, very well-dressed young man who entertained lavishly, didn't drink, but would have a cupboard full of liquor at a time when a black required a permit to buy white man's liquor, and would be entertaining his friends, plying them with alcohol, while he never touched the darn stuff.
I got this phone call. This man said, a very stern voice said, is that Miss Madikizela? I said, yes, sir. And then he said, you may not recall seeing me, but I am the person who usually picks up Dr. Mchi at that bus stop where you wait for your bus. Then he told me his name. He wanted to see me. I tried to avoid the meeting, and he is, of course, very persistent, and he has the type of voice you can't say no to. When he asks you for a favor, he is, in fact, giving you a command in a very polite way. So he was giving me this command to meet him, and the trembling little girl, of course, I said, yes, sir.
The treason trial I'll always remember as having something horrific about it. It was very Kafkaesque and alarming. I was amazed by the courage of all the accused, whether it was Tambo, Mandela or Sisulu, because they were so obviously being trapped and caught into this nightmarish procedure, which was designed, of course, specifically to keep them out of politics, to keep them tied up.
In Johannesburg itself, where the preparatory examination took place, it actually aroused the enthusiasm of our people.
The solidarity, which was increasing almost every day, you could see it. And there, I remember noticing somehow the tall shape of Mandela always so often seemed to be a sort of focus for the others. The command and authority and respect, you could see this leadership sort of changing shape.
Mandela had become a central figure in the trial. His law practice and his family life suffered. He spent less and less time at home with Winnie and their two daughters, who were born during this period.
He would leave me at home every morning and go to the treason trial. If he came back home once a week, we were lucky. We were lucky to see him at all. And when he did come home, he would be going to these meetings, and we were lucky if he came home at 4 o'clock in the morning to be up on the road again to the treason trial in Pretoria.
Day after day, the same people had to come in, endure this day, and then it was a succession of detailed and minor accusations which then went through this cross-examination revealing the police had all been lying.
The government's case collapsed, and all the accused were found not guilty. For 4.5 years, opposition leaders had been tied up by the trial. But in the streets and in the black ghettos, resistance had continued.
What?
It was felt that somebody should go underground and lead the movement. I accepted the challenge with all its difficulties.
The whole country, police, army, everyone had a photograph of Nelson Mandela, who had to be arrested. Immediately, he was seen.
We couldn't really disguise his face. I mean, he'd wear a cap or something from time to time. But it was never satisfactory. We had to take great precautions. We had to blindfold journalists. We had to change cars, sometimes two or three cars.
Do you see Africans being able to develop in this country without the European being pushed out?
South Africa is a country of many races. There is room for all the various races in this country. The Africans want one man, one vote. They want political independence.
Now, if Dr. Verwoerd's government doesn't give you the kind of concessions that you want sometime soon, is there any likelihood of violence?
It is useless and futile for us to continue talking peace and non-violence against a government whose reply is only savage attacks on an unarmed and defenseless people.
In that situation, we had no alternative but to resort to armed struggle. But we made it clear, even as we took that decision, that the responsibility rested squarely on the shoulders of the government, and that we could refrain from this action even at this 11th hour if the government agreed to meet and to sit down with us. But the government believed in strong arm methods, and all that they did was to say, gloves off. There is now going to be a real conflict. We are going to suppress you. And that's what they try to do.
Mandela left the country on a mission to raise funds and get military training for the armed struggle. Upon his return to South Africa, he was caught and arrested.
I must just tell you about his dramatic appearance in court. My word. I was sitting in the court because I was reporting it. Special branch, armed policemen, outside the court, inside the court, thousands of people. Then Winnie came with the suitcase, and she said to the policeman, before court had started, take this down as a change of clothing for Mr. Mandela. This man walked up, and as I say, he was a mighty man, you know. He had beads around his neck. He had a sort of cross over here. He had things around his national dress. Everyone was just shocked at seeing this man in this dramatic attire. And he looked straight at that magistrate. The magistrate was transfixed by this just staring of Mandela, like a mongoose with a snake.
Mandela was sentenced to 5 years for leaving the country illegally and inciting strikes. While he was in prison, his comrades in the armed struggle were arrested. They were found with guns, bombs, and documents that incriminated Mandela. Less than a year into his sentence, he was back in court, this time facing the death penalty for high treason.
In this case, that don't be hopeful. This is a bad case for us. The things that were on that table, different types of arms, the lawyers were so scared. They said, look, these people are caught red-handed.
My wife came before the sentence. And he said, well, look, you have to be strong. I said, that was a reflection of how they were thinking outside.
We were prepared for anything. And because the lawyers were now shaky, we said, they are going to hang. But we will be there with them.
We were concerned that in seeking to defend ourselves in court, we shouldn't say anything that would distort the history of the struggle.
The very speech which was made by Nelson consolidated the spirit of the people outside, because it was a defiant spirit.
He said that democracy and non-racialism were things that he had fought all his life. And in the first draft, he had said that he was prepared to die for it. In discussions, we persuaded him to add three words so that it may not be as challenging as the first draft. The words were, if needs be, I am prepared to die for it. It's the one amendment that he did accept. But when he uttered those words, there was a gasp and then absolute silence.
You know, it became dark in court. You know, we didn't even know that the clouds are gathering. It became dark and the rain just fell. And it was all quiet. After that, some of us said, those are the last words he is giving us.
I have fought against white domination, and I have fought against black domination. I have cherished the idea of a democratic and free society in which all persons live together in harmony and with equal opportunity. It is an ideal which I hope to live for and to achieve. But If needs be, it is an ideal for which I am prepared to die.
Mandela and his comrades were sentenced to life on Robben Island, a notorious prison off the coast of Cape Town.
I believe the way in which you'll be treated by the prison authorities depends on your demeanor. And you must fight that battle and win it on the very first day. Two chaps came through the passage, and they were very aggressive. And they selected Molite, who was a gentleman, you know, very soft, very courteous chap. And this captain says, "Why is your hair so long? Don't you know the regulations?" And Molite, you know, couldn't handle such an aggressive approach. And he says, "Your hair is long, like this boy's," pointing at me. And I say, "Look here," I couldn't finish that sentence. When he dashed, charged on me, against me, and I said to him, "You dare touch me, I will take you to the highest court in the land. And by the time I finish with you, you will be as poor as a church mouse." That stopped him on his tracks.
They had indoctrinated these chaps very, very thoroughly. Everyone was frightened of us. You know, they had painted a picture of wild, unruly, undisciplined, violent terrorists. So that for the first month, while we were in our cells, locked up, now our cells had windows leading into the passage, they'd brought warders from many prisons throughout South Africa. And they'd walk down the passage, stand at the cells, and stare at us like animals in the zoo.
Some warders questioned, "Must we be so cruel to people whose only crime is to want justice, equality?" And others say, "No, we should treat them harshly so that when they go out, they will know that the white man is the boss." And the others say, "No, the lesson of history is that these people eventually win. And if we treat them like this, that is how they will treat us when they come into power."
Their task was to break our morale. Visits and letters once in 6 months. One letter, one visit.
"My darling Winnie, your visit last month was quite unexpected. And that might be one reason I enjoyed it so much. The mere sight of you kindles a thousand fires in me. Your beautiful photo still stands above my left shoulder as I write this note. I dust it carefully every morning, for to do so gives me the pleasant feeling that I'm caressing you as in the old days. I even touch your nose with mine to recapture the electric current that used to flush through my blood whenever I did so."
In January of 65, they took us out to the lime quarry. Now, we were addressed by the Commissioner of Prisons, General Steyn, He called us all together and said, look, this work will last for about 6 months, and then we're going to give you soft labor. That lime quarry work, I think, lasted for about 13 years.
The work itself, which was very difficult, of course, kept you fit. You would stand out on top there and started digging. And then it gradually comes down. And that is why you see these lines. As you break that platform, then the level gradually comes down until you come right down here.
When they took us to the quarry to go and dig lime, by the end of the day, our hands were bleeding. We had not, of course, been accustomed to work with pick and shovel.
We had no toilet facilities. We went into that tunnel for toilet facilities. And you dug a hole and you closed it. And sometimes you dug a hole and you found that somebody had sat there, you see. It was a messy affair.
When you were at the quarry face, the waters would count us every half an hour, every 3/4 hour. They count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If there are not 30 prisoners, out comes the dogs.
They would decide before we leave the prison. They say, now today we want to punish so-and-so. We want to punish Neville Alexander and Magweto. And it did not matter how hard they worked that day. At the end of the day, the warder would say, Magweto, Neville, Alexander, I want you to appear before the head of the prison for refusing to work. And people become punished.
He stood his ground firmly to expose the jail conditions to visiting people like judges, magistrates, or visitors from wherever.
We got into prison in 72, and what we did during that period within a year appeared too radical for most of the prisoners on Roppen Island.
We still had illusions about coming out after 2 years, being liberated by the victorious revolution and all the rest of it. And therefore, you know, really giving them hell inside while our comrades outside were doing their thing.
Through prison grapevine, we knew that Nelson is making the representations. He's the person that negotiates with the prison authorities and all that. They said, wow, Nelson was doing all this. How come we're in such shit?
We had to be put straight by the Mandelas, who were older people, first of all. Secondly, had been in prison before, had gone through hell in the 50s already with the Defiance Campaign and all that, and knew what prison really means in South Africa. And we didn't know. I mean, none of us had ever been in a prison.
We used to play chess on Robben Island. And Nelson wasn't one of the greater players. He would take days, I'm not exaggerating, 3 days, 4 days to finish a single game. No, but that's part of the man's makeup. Sometimes he becomes very inscrutable, he's slow. And very smart, very adept. He can listen to you, work out in his own mind, and do things.
We encouraged all our chaps to study. And we also acted as teachers at work. We had no blackboards, we had no paper. We used the sand.
Somebody would have prepared a lesson the night before. And as we worked, you see, he would then lecture to the others on what he read. And they would discuss the lecture.
For days on end, debates would go on. And that's true, you know, sometimes you say that debates go on for 30 days, 40 days. Time was not a problem in that sense. But yet, on the other end, we would not waste 3 minutes doing nothing. If you wanted to talk to me about something, I say, okay, let's make a time. We couldn't say 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock before lunch or after breakfast. But the point is that all of us operated, and this was true, as if time was running out.
My mother had struggled, and I was able to support her for some time when I was now practicing as a lawyer. I was arrested. She struggled again. And she came to see me several times. And the last time she came to see me, I could see that she was going. In fact, you know, as she was leaving for the dock, I turned around and I looked at her. And the way she was walking, I felt that that was the last time I had seen her. And her death was one of the saddest moments I heard.
Nelson is a person who doesn't share his grief. He likes to keep his grief to himself. It's like pulling his blanket tight over his body. And he just like this, you know.
They were harassing my wife and were not getting any newspapers. Whenever my wife was arrested, then they cut out and made a cutting and just left it on my table as I was away at work. And I come back and I see my wife has been arrested.
My darling Winnie, our daughters raised in hardship are grown women today. The firstborn has her own house and is raising a family. I had hoped to build you a refuge, no matter how small, so that we would have a place for rest and sustenance before the arrival of the sad, dry days. I fell down and couldn't do these things. I am as one building castles in the air.
One of the dreams I constantly had in prison was me going home and getting out in the middle of the city and having to walk from town to Soweto. And reaching home, finding that the house was open, that there was nobody at home, and being concerned as to what has happened to women and the children.
One morning, there was the usual bang on all the doors, and I thought I was being arrested as usual. I was told to follow them to the trucks, and then we were driven to the Free State. We were taken to this house in Brantford. There wasn't even a floor, and there I was expected to live.
She lived in a small, miserable, four-roomed house in an area where everybody spoke Sesotho. No one understood Xhosa. I suppose this is why she was banned to this area. But she was beginning to grow a vegetable garden. She was starting women's self-help groups, beginning to really interact and work with the local community.
In Brantford, I would either have been totally broken or survived. And I decided to survive.
Messages of love from our leaders inside prisons who share with you the pain of our country. The solution to this country's problem lies in this black hand. That day is not far when we shall lead you to freedom. Amanda!
Hey,
ever be one man, one vote in South Africa?
No.
Isn't that why you are almost certain to be faced with a bloody war?
No, but there's not one man, one vote anywhere in
because
Africa.
20 million black people in your country wish to have the vote.
No, but you see, your problem is, it is no use. You keep on arguing about 20 million blacks.
Will there be one man, one vote?
Certainly. That is inevitable. There will be one man, one vote in this country, and there will be a majority government in this country. But that majority government will accommodate everybody.
Led by?
Mandela. He is prisoner number 220/82. And he writes, "My darling mum, I often wonder just how far more difficult it would have been for me to take the decision to leave you behind if I had been able to see clearly the countless perils and hardships to which you would be exposed in my absence. Your love and support, the raw warmth of your body, is what life and happiness means to me. I love you. Devotedly, Madiba."
After 7 years of banishment, Winnie defied the government and tried to return home to Soweto.
I don't drag me. I am coming. Don't drag me. Sorry. I know what arrest means. What do you think you're doing?
I'm taking it.
What are you doing?
Come.
Don't push me.
Winnie came out of her banishment and she took over these young people as if they were her own children. And there in her Orlando home, there were some rooms at the back and they were living there. And they were an obnoxious lot, there's no doubt about it. But as far as Winnie is concerned, they were her children and they could do no wrong.
I am back with you where I belong. This is now the right time to take your country. We have no arms. We have stones. We have boxes of matches. We have cotton.
Circumstances under which you would talk with and release Nelson Mandela?
I'm only prepared to talk to people who want constitutional change, but I'm not prepared to talk to people who want revolutionary change.
Botha offered to release Mandela if he renounced the ANC and the armed struggle.
My father says, "I have always been a member of the African National Congress. And I will remain a member of the African National Congress until the day I die. I cannot and will not give any undertaking at a time when I and you, the people, are not free. Your freedom and mine cannot be separated."
We need Nelson Mandela. That is our leader. That is our leader. Release our leader.
I've been lenient and patient. Don't push us too far. Don't push us too far.
When his release might be possible?
Unfortunately, the obstacles still exist.
As I have pointed out, the onus is on Mr. de Klerk. As far as the family is concerned, we are back to where we have to pressure for his release once more.
The prohibition of the African National Congress, the Pan-Africanist Congress, the South African Communist Party, and a number of subsidiary organizations is being rescinded. I wish to put it plainly that the government has taken a firm decision to release Mr. Mandela unconditionally.
My boy, I'm Mandela.
Now that I'm back, I have the opportunity to concern myself with my wife and to try and assure her that her problems will now be shared by both of us.
Months after the release of her husband, Winnie Mandela was charged with assault, kidnapping, and murder. 2 years earlier, Stompie Moeketsi, a 14-year-old political activist, had been abducted by her bodyguards and brought to her home. He was found later with his throat slit.
Nelson never believed that she was responsible for the killing of Stompie. He stood by her, despite a difficult personal relationship. Knowing him as well as I do, I would have expected him to do precisely what he did. He is a particularly loyal person.
Even their own court found us not having assaulted any child. Yeah. We did not make a stomp. We were found guilty of by the media. Yeah. Amanda! Amanda!
With the white minority government no longer firmly in control, a struggle for power erupted. The ANC had majority support, and its members demanded immediate change. Inkatha, a mostly Zulu party led by Buthelezi, insisted on recognition as a major force. The neo-fascist extreme right wanted a separate white homeland. The government of de Klerk did little to control the violence.
Mr. Mandela is in a meeting. Who called
just the perception that there's ANC and Inkatha and political violence. And there we've got to explain that apartheid has been a violent system, that control of people was achieved through brutal suppression, using the security forces, using their surrogates.
Right now what has happened, the internal stability unit has actually gone to a clinic and they have shot it down.
Are we certain that it was the internal stability unit? Who saw it?
They were saying that now it's the internal stability unit that was shooting at the clinic.
But so who actually saw them? At what time of the day was it?
Well, we haven't got those details, but I think we can find them.
Yes, Mr. Mandela wants to speak to the minister very urgently.
Hold on, please.
The first meeting I had with him was about 5 minutes. All he did was to say, look, I'd like you to come and work in my office. And I thought, good God, you know, this man. It was like looking, facing your own hero. My first impression was that he was exceptionally dignified. Very gentle, very kind, very straightforward. Those are the things that are Madiba for me.
After 27 years of isolation in prison, Mandela became a central figure in the negotiations for the creation of a new South Africa.
To resent that any party with the government should reach an understanding and make a decision which impacts on the rest of South Africans without any representation of the rest of us.
Speakers of every other language.
An organization which remains committed to an armed struggle cannot be fully trusted, cannot be trusted completely when it also commits itself to peacefully negotiated solutions. The ANC has not honored important undertakings and has resorted to delaying tactics.
I am gravely concerned about the behavior of Mr. de Klerk. Even the head of an illegitimate, discredited minority regime as his has certain moral standards to uphold. He has abused his position because he hoped that I would not reply. He was completely mistaken. I am replying now.
In an attempt to stop the negotiations, the far right stormed the conference center. Despite all attempts to prevent the elections, a date was set, April 27th, 1994.
He didn't speak about it. He never discussed it. Madiba can't talk about things that really hurt him very much. He can't. But he then said, tomorrow I'm going to announce that I will be having a legal separation from my wife. And I was very worried because Madiba never ever spoke to me in that kind of formal way where he would say something. I know that he was very hurt.
The relationship between myself and my wife, comrade Nomzamo Winnie Mandela, has become the subject of much media speculation. My love for her remains undiminished. However, in view of the tensions that have arisen owing to differences between ourselves in a number of issues in recent months, we have mutually agreed that a separation would be best for each one of us. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you'll appreciate the pain I have gone through. It was a decision which was, in fact, tragic, but it had to be taken, and I have taken it. And I think it was a correct decision to take. But I don't want to get into details about those matters.
I think it hurt him because I think even now he honestly, he loves Winnie very much. And I think people need to understand that. It's the one person for 27 years who was constantly his friend.
the Nobel Peace Prize laureates for 1993, Nelson Mandela and Frederick William de Klerk.
This is not the time for me to speak of our justified grievances of the past. As South Africans, this is the time for us to speak of what is best for the future of our country. Mr. de Klerk and I will continue to be political opponents. I have nevertheless decided to accept the Nobel Peace Prize jointly with him as the gesture of reconciliation.
Just to see that we're still friends.
That's right. Thank you.
Friendly opponent.
Our people, not only Africans, colors, and Indians, we want to unite colors, Africans, Indians, and whites. That is why we are talking to the National Party who have been killing our people. We want this peace, this spirit of reconciliation. That spirit must not only bring the government and ourselves together, it must bring our own people. Those who have been working with the enemy, they must now work with us in order to build this new South Africa.
That stadium roof collapsed before we came?
Before we got these.
Oh, I see. I didn't even notice it, you know?
29 people were injured, but there was no death. Speed up here.
Are you all right?
Thank you.
I'm so happy to see you. Very happy.
Okay, which crew is it? I'm sorry, you're really holding us up, so you're going to have to move faster, okay? Thanks. I'm sorry. But we want you to move faster so that he can move faster. Please.
But look, I mean, he turns into...
Okay, let's
just turn into a ward there, man.
Dada, don't you have other clothes? Is that the only shirt you have?
Everybody just looks at my face, man. It doesn't look at my clothes.
No.
I can assure you.
No. What happened? You don't have a shirt. You don't have a business.
No. At what time do we go away?
At 9.
No. I'll be all right. I'll be all right.
I don't think so. You've been wearing that shirt for 2 days now.
No. I wore it yesterday. But I'll change before.
Okay.
Why should we agree to a thing like that? Where was the argument? And you mean our fellows agreed without referring this matter to us? Well, I take strong exception to that. You must tell Cyril. I don't think you should take a decision of that nature without letting me know. I'm totally opposed to that, but you can go on.
I'm
jalo shumaya nukolo. Wethu bolengcinezelo liphelile. Inyani yahlele inyani. Noba kuyini. Namhlanje uzawukhumsha kwedini babhideke bathi kebe umlungu. Ukhumsha amabhulu athi yayayaya. Ukhumsha amangesi athi yes, yes, yes. Hamba nathi dibomhle. Awu!
Our elections office has been bombed.
What?
The ANC office in Bulfontein, Orange Free State. This morning, and Jeanette wanted you to...
Bulfontein.
That the ANC office in Bulfontein in Orange Free State was bombed last night.
If they think that by killing our people, they are going to stop the election on the 27th of April, they live in a fool's paradise. That election is going to take place with or without the right
people. Yes, good morning. I'm calling from the office of Mr. Mandela. Could you put us through to the office of the minister, please?
I just want to read you the document which has been sent to me. 13 houses torched since last night by well-armed IFP hostel dwellers. At least 3 deaths reported. I must confess that I'm having difficulties with General Fandamere. He has told me virtually, after I put a lot of pressure on him, that there's very little that the police can do about the situation in Natal.
A month before the election, Inkatha marched into downtown Johannesburg, where they clashed with the African National Congress. Without Inkatha participation, a peaceful election was impossible. Last-ditch attempts to bring Buthelezi on board seemed to get nowhere.
One thing that we must make clear is that the 27th of April cannot be postponed. And secondly, that the integrity and sovereignty of our country cannot be violated.
We've come to the brink of a very serious situation.
An ANC proposal containing provisions to be implemented by a government of national unity after elections was found to be unacceptable by His Majesty and his delegation.
I would like to warn that we should have no exaggerated expectations as to what this task group is likely to achieve. I don't know what else can be done with Buthelezi, but I don't want to discuss the matter with you over the telephone. I am coming to see Mr. de Klerk tomorrow. And I wouldn't mind to see if the senior ministers are there, because this is a very serious situation.
With time running out, a secret deal was struck between the government, the ANC, and Buthelezi.
I'm pleased to announce that the Inkatha Freedom Party will contest elections in the national and provincial levels, even though it's so late in the day.
This agreement is a leap forward for peace, reconciliation, nation building, and an inclusive election process.
702, welcome on board the John Burke Show on 702 Talk Radio on this historic Wednesday, the 27th of April.
Make a good life, you gotta make a boat. 400 years of African history.
I'm the king of South Africa.
I'm very, very happy.
And I hope that from now on there will be peace in this country.
Now, I feel like giving birth to a new baby.
I feel I'm on top of the world. I'm very proud of the new South Africa, the new family.
Home comes a man of vision. Thinking about the evil man's mind. Apartheid is gone now. This gun will be the limit. Let them work together in heart. Brothers and sisters, hand in hand.
Chief Justice will then announce the results. Nelson Mandela, state president, so announces.
The best thing is to say,
so we just invite them to the ceremony, yeah. And you'll invite them later at the
end.
Fine.
Yes.
Okay. So there are 120 heads of state coming now. And there is no way, 120.
Yeah.
There is no way, Tata, that you're going to be able to accord them all the respect you should in the short time we have.
I see.
Now, some will get 10 minutes, some will get 5 minutes, some will get a handshake.
The dress in the evening. Mm-hmm. What is the what do we decide, by the way?
You must, well, it's acceptable for you to wear, and it's not acceptable for you not to wear a bow tie, a black bow tie.
I would like something which indicates that we are not far from the lifestyle of our people.
A bow tie in the evening is formal but festive.
And you look so handsome in it. We've worn it in Washington, you've won it at the Carlton.
Hard thing, bow tie, man. It's not something that I would feel most uncomfortable. Every time I put on that thing, I can't even talk. I find it difficult to talk. And, I would prefer just a suit.
Okay.
But it must be a dignified suit and
no,
so on.
No.
I, Nelson Mandela, do hereby swear to devote myself to the well-being of the Republic and all its people.
Will you please raise your right hand and say, so help me God.
So help me God.
Ngenxa yokujonga umsebenzi awusebenzayo ndabona uba akanguwethu kangokwaMandela